Everyone, this is Josh Epstein. I am the marketing specialist for the TDA Perks program. I want to welcome you all to today's webinar, HIPAA, how it impacts your practice, how to comply electronically, and the common misconceptions that are faced. Our presenter today is Mr. Don Douglas, who is the COO of iMedicor. Just want to remind you before we start, that TDA Perks, we offer our members an array of valuable endorsed partners, several educational resources such as articles, podcasts, and free classes. All of these webinars will be archived at your convenience, so you can go to the TDA Perks website, which is on our screen right now, and find them there in our articles and resource section. There will also be a Q&A session available at the conclusion of this event. And there's on the right side of your panel, you should see a box where you can add your questions. So right now, I am going to pass the presentation to Don. And Don, you should be ready to go. Thank you, man. Thank you.
Okay, good afternoon, everybody. First, thank you, Josh, and to the TDA for the opportunity to present to you guys today. Yes, as Josh mentioned, it's HIPAA and how it impacts your practice and some common misconceptions. So HIPAA is the five-letter word or five-letter acronym that we all hate, but it's kind of like insurance. We have to follow it. We have to abide by it. So how does it impact your practice? So let's talk about some history. HIPAA, the Health Insurance Portability and Accountability Act, was passed in 1996 by Bill Clinton. And essentially what it was to do was, one, to establish national standards to protect the individual patient health information. It was also to create safeguards and limitations on how that information could be used and transferred. And then lastly, it also gave the patients the rights over their patient health information. So one of the common misconceptions out there is that the person that actually maintains the health records owns the information, and that's not correct. Actually, the patient is the owner of that information. So that's what the HIPAA privacy rules gave that right over to the patient. So who can cause a violation? So essentially the most simple answer is anyone with access to patient health information. So not just the providers, not just the administration or the front end of the office, or it could be the cleaning crew or the IT support. So when you go home at night, If you're leaving information laying out, that person is in violation because they have access to that information. And so the security rule applies to not just healthcare providers, but also applies to insurance companies, clearinghouses, pharmacies, and things of that nature. And they're what's called covered entities. So who is a covered entity? Another misconception is that the patient is a covered entity, and they are not. The patient, because they own that health information, have the ability to post that on a billboard if they wanted to. That's their health information, and they can do whatever they like with it. Unfortunately, everyone else doesn't have that liberty. So if you're a healthcare provider, whether you're a doctor, again, a dentist, a chiropractor, a pharmacy, you are considered a covered entity. So we said in 1996, HIPAA law was passed, but there was no real enforcement. And so it wasn't until 13 years later, when the American Recovery and Reinvestment Act was passed. And that is commonly referred to as the stimulus package. So approximately $787 billion was put towards this program. And out of that came what's called the HITECH Act. And it's another acronym for Health Information Technology for Economic and Clinical Health. And so what that did is that basically put monies towards what's called the Meaningful Use Program. So if anyone's not familiar with Meaningful Use is essentially a federal program that allows a doctor or provider to receive up to $63,750 to convert from paper records over to electronic records. And so the idea there was that everybody was going to create this digital technology so that the health information could be transferred back and forth from disparate EHRs and different systems, with ease of use, and it would improve better health care outcomes. But unfortunately, that wasn't the case because everybody developed their own software with their own code, and nobody communicated. And so that's kind of where the interoperability, if you've ever heard of that word, comes in. But that's a whole other webinar. So anyway, so also in 2009, the authority to enforce HIPAA was given over to the Office of Civil Rights, or known as the OCR. And what that basically did is that gave the HIPAA law teeth. And now they have the ability to come after you, not just civilly, but also criminally. And so in addition to that, they also gave the state attorneys generals the authority to go in and pursue civil actions as well. So $36.5 billion were set aside for this program. Out of the high tech came what's called Subtitle D. And this Subtitle D basically just strengthens the laws when it comes to transferring electronic patient health information, or what we refer to as EPHI. And so, as we mentioned, those penalties can be not just civil but criminal. So the civil penalties can range anywhere from $50,000 per page up to $1.5 million per incident or per patient. And those things can range varied on the corresponding tier. So if you just didn't know and you made a mistake, well, they look at that at one level. But if you knew it was a law and you willingly neglect the law, well, then that's a whole higher penalty. So the penalties can compound. So then the next progression of the HIPAA law was in 2013 was the Omnibus Rule. And essentially what this did is this strengthened the laws to govern and enforce, and then also it also expanded the patient's rights to their records. So, for example, if a patient requests their records, you know, by law, as a provider, you have up to 30 days to provide that information. And currently, you can do that in many different methods. Well, there's new legislation, there's new legislation coming out very soon that's going to state that if the provider has the ability to convert that record into a PDF or create a PDF, they're going to be responsible for transmitting that information electronically. So they're slowly pushing everything towards electronic transfer. So again, kind of a quick HIPAA timeline. 1996, the law was passed. Again, no real enforcement. 2009, lots of enforcement. The Office of Civil Rights has the authority, state attorneys generals, and then the High Tech Act, they actually put some money behind that. And so that's when people started reporting HIPAA violations and so forth. And then again, in 2013, they enforced the laws again. So what's happened in between then and now? So you can see, since they passed that, you can see that the HIPAA violations that have been reported are steadily moving up and to the right. And so HIPAA enforcement is not a myth. Again, for many years it wasn't enforced, but now it's being enforced. And so, you know, direct from the Director of Office of Civil Rights, for Civil Rights, excuse me, Leon Rodriguez, you can see here, they are out to vigorously enforce the HIPAA privacy and security protections. So again, what are the penalties? They can range from $50,000 per page up to $1.5 million per incident. And then again, can include jail time as well, anywhere from 1 to 10 years. And so we hear a lot from the dentists saying, look, you know, we see it for the medical industry, but the, you know, dentists aren't being hit with this stuff. And so we just want to kind of show here, and you can Google this, but there was a dentist in Indiana that was fined for $12,000. And although that's on the lower scale, $12,000 is a lot of money, especially to a small practice. And then you can see here where another dentist was hit for a $150,000 fine for unencrypted information. And then the third one there was a California dentist. In this particular case, he actually breached over 500 records. And the law states that whenever you have a breach of 500 or more, you actually have to publish that out in the public record. So in the newspaper, you've got to put that information out there that you have basically breached the records of your patients. And so we're seeing a lot of that in different areas as well, with like credit cards and so forth. So here's one, it's not in the dentist industry, but adult pediatric dermatology, $150,000 for not securing their email. Here was a big one, Columbia Presbyterian, $4.8 million, again, because they failed to secure the patient health information. And then, if you don't believe they're coming for it, just take the words from the Chief Regional Counsel of the Office for Civil Rights. They basically, in 2013, wrapped up a 115 different practice HIPAA audit pilot program. And what they tried to find out is, if we go out there, how much money can we bring back? And you can see here, just in that one pilot program, they were actually able to recoup over $10 million in HIPAA fines. And they believe that that is low compared to what's coming. You got to keep in mind, guys, that you know, when you start the audit process, it's a process. It's a time. It takes time to process through the system. And so we believe that you're going to start seeing more and more of these reports of violations coming to the forefront here in the next year or two. So you've gone through, you've trained your staff, you studied up on HIPAA, and you're making sure you're doing all the right things. And some of the things that people disregard are some of the equipment that's in your office. So if you're currently using a copier or a multifunction product or a fax machine, keep in mind that you could be jeopardizing a HIPAA violation here. So let's take like a fax, for example. And basically in the red there, you'll see those are the actual laws from HIPAA. But can you verify the identity of everyone receiving a fax from your practice? Again, when you send that fax over, when it comes out, is that fax machine sitting next to the receptionist? And if so, is that information laying out there where somebody that's checking in for their next appointment can easily look over and identify somebody else's information? Again, if that's happening, you're breaking the law. Can you confirm the sender and receiving system doesn't utilize a hard drive to store the information? A lot of people don't know that your modern day equipment today has hard drives in it, just like your computer. So you want to keep that in mind. And then can you confirm that the person sending and receiving are qualified staff? You know, a common misconception is if I work for the doctor, I should have access to that information. Well, that's not the case. There's been a lot of cases where people have accessed people's health information within their in that practice for alternative vindictive actions. And so if you're not working with that patient and you don't have the right to see that information, you're breaking the law. So how do we currently send patient records now? Back in the day, the fax machines were what's called peer-to-peer. And peer-to-peer essentially was a secure way of transmitting information back and forth. Well, that's kind of gone away with the voice over IP. So now when you scan that information into your fax machine, if you're using VoIP, that information is transmitted into digital information, ones and zeros. And if I have the proper technologies, I can capture that information and I can decrypt it and then have that patient health information right there in front of me. So the fax machines are no longer really HIPAA compliant. And then going back to the hard drives, you have a copier or a multifunction device in your office, you're scanning and you're faxing and emailing and copying. Well, all that information is being stored on a hard drive. These digital copiers now have hard drives. And so at the end of your lease or at the end of the tenure of your copier, it's done its use, you sell it or you return it back to the leasing company. Well, that machine is taken and broken down for parts and sold or resold to other people. So if you haven't verified that that hard drive was cleared, that information is now sitting in somebody else's office or somebody else's place of business. So our recommendation is to make sure that when you turn that copier in, make sure you have that hard drive removed or have that hard drive erased. And so that's a real big one that a lot of people aren't aware of. So there's two sections of focus as far as we're concerned on the HIPAA side for electronic messaging. And one was the HIPAA privacy rule, which we just discussed. And then also there's the security rule. And the basic security rule is the standards in which we can transmit that electronic PHI. And so the government states, the HIPAA states that one, you have to have what's called an audit control. And so an audit control is just simply a trail to where we can see exactly where that information went, that email, who it went to, what time they opened it. And so it's a very detailed trail of that information. And so if the federal government comes in and audits you, you're going to need this big time. And then next is the integrity controls. And integrity just basically means making sure that that information is not improperly altered, it's not destroyed, it's not manipulated, it's not changed in any manner. And then transmission security. Transmission security is essentially encryption and decryption. And so a common mistake today is that, you know, if I'm encrypted, I'm HIPAA compliant, and that's just not the case. You also have person or entity authentication. Again, this goes back to being able to identify the person that's sending or receiving the PHI. And then you have what's called automatic log off. And so, you know, you have to have the ability that when you get up at the end of the day or for lunch or for a break, there has to be a predetermined time that that software, that system is going to turn itself off or deactivate the access to the information. And so that that is very important. And then encryption is just, again, basically just a restatement of the transmission security, but you can see the law there beside it. Now, the next screen, you've heard the adage, never believe anything you hear and only half of what you see. And so what we would recommend is that you make sure that no matter what your vendor tells you, that they be able to back it up and actually show you proof. And so this is a good example of where a very large person in the dental market space, you guys probably may use this this vendor, but they had to settle for $250,000 because they falsely misled their customers on the encryption level of their Dentrix G5 software program. And so they advertised one thing, but the actual fact was it wasn't anywhere near what they had stated. So again, make sure that whatever your provider tells you, make sure you get that in writing or get some type of proof. Just don't take the word. So how do you currently send your patient records? You know, are you using Yahoo? Are you using the fax machine, Gmail, Outlook? We find a lot of people are still utilizing this method. You know, we just say, hey, it's not secure. It's not encrypted. No audit trail. No audit log off. No BAA. No business associates agreement. It's not HIPAA compliant. And either we found that either dentists don't know about the law, or they don't know the details of the law, or they just don't think it's going to ever affect them. And so as we demonstrated today, that's just not the case. So if you're utilizing these other third-party non-secure services, they don't meet the requirements, please be very careful. And don't confuse, another big misconception is if I'm encrypted, I'm HIPAA compliant, which is not the case. Again, you know, unfortunately, we don't have the ability to pick and choose the laws that we want to follow. And so there are five technical safeguards that we must follow. And so encryption is only one of those five. So what should you look for when you're out there looking for your HIPAA compliant email system? We talked about the transmission security. So this is the encryption. You know, the NIST standards is 256. And I would just tell you that there are websites out there, discrete websites that utilize 256 that have been hacked, and you've heard about that in the news. The Department of Defense utilizes 1,024-bit encryption. And so we would recommend that you use the max bit encryption, which at this time and date is 2,048-bit encryption. And there's been studies done by a company called DigiCert, and they're a leader in encryption technology. And their own study showed that utilizing modern-day technology today, it would take approximately 6.4 quadrillion years to break the code. So, you know, I'm not able to really quantify a quadrillion, so I just know that it's longer than I'm going to be alive. And so next is the audit control. Again, have your vendor provide you proof of this. Have them show you the audit trail. This is very important. You need to be able to prove, if you're ever audited, you have to be able to prove the information that went from point A to point B and how it got there and when it got there and all the details in between. And then the next is your integrity controls. Again, we have to protect it. Your vendor has to protect that information and make sure it's not altered or destroyed, and they have to store it for at least 6 years. 6 years is the, up to 6 years in an encrypted manner. So again, ask these questions. And then automatic log off. You know, does the software automatically terminate itself when you get up and walk away? Again, you get up at the end of the day, you go home, and the cleaning crew comes in. And if you didn't log that system off, well, now your cleaning crew, your maintenance crew, anybody that comes in there now has access to all of your patient health information that's available. The next thing we'd like to encourage is what's called micro-tokenization. And micro-tokenization is basically, it's a encrypting the email, but it's also siloing the email off. So Let me give you the best type of example in modern day today as we do in our everyday business. If you go and purchase something with a debit or a credit card, now the cards have this chip. And so what that chip does is it basically silos off, or it basically separates that one transaction by itself. Because remember, we talked about the penalties. If I break into your Yahoo or your Gmail accounts, then I'm going to have access to all of your emails. So every email that has patient health information is subject to a $50,000 per page penalty. So with the micro tokenization, what our system does, it basically encrypts and silos off each email individually. So if some reason, somehow by chance, they were able to break that 6.4 quadrillion year code, then they only have access to that one email, which limits your liability. So again, micro tokenization, very, very, we believe is very important. So next one is make sure there's no PHI, there's no patient health information in the body of your email. So when your patient receives that initial email stating, hey, we've got your patient, secure patient health information here, make sure none of that information is listed within the body of that email. And then third-party verification. Again, make sure you know who you're sending and receiving the information from. And we recommend what's called the Direct Protocol. And the Direct Protocol is a federal program that basically validates and verifies everyone that's in that system. And so when you receive an email from, Dr. Douglas at Direct, you know that that person has been validated, has been verified, and actually been registered with the federal government. They actually receive a certificate that says, hey, this end user is messaging in a HIPAA-compliant manner. And so you can feel very confident that you're receiving it from a validated source. And then cloud-based system. Everything is going to the cloud. I know that there's a lot of hesitation about it, but as you'll see, the cloud is completely secure. It's more secure than your office, because in your office, if you have servers and hard drives, you have to make sure that all those items are also protected and are also HIPAA compliant. And so that's just another additional headache that you have to worry about. So we recommend cloud-based systems. And then lastly, make sure that whoever you're working with is willing to sign a business associates agreement. And so for those who may not be aware, a BAA basically transfers the responsibility to the person that you're sending that information to. And they're basically signing that document saying, hey, we are going to abide by the HIPAA rule and the standards. So, I'm at a core, we are a preferred vendor for the TDA, but what we want to make sure is that you also want to make sure that whoever you utilize can integrate into your system. So whether you want to use them as a standalone system, or if you already have a current EHR system that you utilize and you don't want to disrupt your workflow, make sure that third-party vendor can integrate through the back end of the system and still send that information in a HIPAA-compliant manner. And, again, we are a vendor, preferred vendor for the TDA, and we appreciate that opportunity. And, everything that we've spoken about, we make sure that we live by. And if you ever have any questions or need any support, that's what we do. We're happy to provide any information for you as far as protection with no commitment to the product. But we definitely appreciate your time. And this will conclude the presentation. So, Josh, I'll turn it back over to you. And if we have any questions, I'll be happy to answer.
Yes, again, if you have any question, there's a question box there. And you can feel free to ask Don any questions that you wish. So we'll take a couple minutes for Q&A. Again, if you have questions, just write that down in the box and on the right, and Don will be happy to answer them. I see a question here. What do you charge through Perks? And that's through Dr. Redwanski.
Okay, yeah, as a preferred vendor, we provide TDA members a 35% discount, so it's $22.50 per month. There are no installation charges, there's no setup fees, there's no upgrade charges, there's no file size limitations, there's no storage capacities. Again, we'll store that information up to 6 years. Again, there's no increased charge for the storage. It's a one price. That's it. What you see, and it covers everything, training for the life of the contract.
And that actually can be found on the iMedicorps landing page on the TDA Perks website for more information.
Yep.
Are there any other questions? Okay, I have one more question here. How does this work if receiving doctor is not your client?
Okay, I'm sorry, I have my window.
And that's with Dr. David Ward.
Okay, great question. So if if that doctor is not inside the network, basically what you receive with our program is you receive two emails. You receive the direct protocol email, which validates you in the system, and then you also receive what we call a patient mail. And what this patient mail will allow you to do is to communicate directly to your patient or to communicate with another provider that's outside of the network, still in a completely HIPAA-compliant manner. So what they will simply receive is an email. They have a link. There's no PHI within the email. They hit that link, and it ties them into our server securely. And now they can view that information, whether it be an X-ray or a patient health chart, and they can respond to you directly. They can't print that information. They can't forward that information. And that's all designed to protect you as the provider.
Excellent, Don. It looks like we have one more question here. Can you use Amazon Workmail or Google Business and have it compliant?
I'm not very familiar with those systems, but what I would recommend to do is that we would be happy to research that information for you, do a little background check on it. Again, you should be able to ask that provider if they can provide you these five technical safeguards to make sure that they comply with these five areas. And if they can do that and they'll sign that DAA, then you should be covered.
Okay, and again, my name is Josh Epstein. You can call me anytime, 512-443-3675, and I'll be happy to get in with iMedicorps to relay any of your questions as well as with any of our other partners. We definitely want to appreciate your attending this event, and I want to thank Don for his time and valuable information. So thanks again, Don, and just a reminder, all of these webinars that we provide monthly are archived on our site, so feel free to check them out. And please visit tdaperks.com, and that's a good option or a good opportunity to review all of our other vendors. And definitely keep an eye out for our weekly newsletters and new programs. So again, we will be presenting new monthly webinars, so you definitely want to take care of and take account of that. And again, of course, my number here or any of the PERK staff, you can reach us at 512-443-3675 or tdaperks.com, and we'll be happy to help you. So until next time, take care, and thank you for participating. Have a great weekend.
Thanks, Josh.